We're going to keep it kind of casual and dialogue-based, so we're going to stay here at ground level instead of up in podium land. And our goal today is to discuss and demonstrate some ways that CISOs can really take lessons learned from the entrepreneur and startup community, because when it comes down to it, pitching your next business is fairly similar to pitching out your cybersecurity strategy. It just gets a little bit tricky when you start talking about those returns. So it is my great pleasure, and I probably should have not walked away without my clicker, to dive into that. So again, what we're going to talk about today is, what if a CISO thought like an entrepreneur? And to help guide us through that discussion, I would like to welcome Paul Orlando, who is the director of USC's, University of Southern California's Incubator Program, and adjunct professor of the Lloyd Greif Center for Entrepreneurial Studies. So with that, Paul, thanks for joining us here today. And let's begin with kind of the first set of principles. So, leading the organization.
Great. And welcome, everyone. As a little way to introduce some of these, I'll just maybe introduce myself.
Perfect.
You know, and how did I come to some of the perspectives I'm going to share with you. So like Simone said, yeah, I am a professor now. I ended up being a professor. Didn't seek that path out, really. Long story. But I've shifted over the last 5 or 6 years from running my own business, and instead I've ended up just helping a lot of other businesses grow. So in the last 5, 6 years now, I've worked with about 150 companies in very broad, broadly different types of industries and different parts of the world. And I've really primarily done this in 3 different startup accelerator programs. So the one I'm at right now, where I've been for about 3 years, is at the USC. So it's a university-run program. But I also ran 2 other startup accelerators, one in Hong Kong themed around mobile development, and another one that was themed around environmental tech, and was actually based in Rome and was connected to the Vatican. Again, like a little bit of an unusual setup. But when we talk about how you, in a cybersecurity role, might think about being entrepreneurial, we're going to introduce some, a bit of a framework that you might think about. And one thing that I think comes up a lot is risk, or appetite for risk. Right?
Absolutely. Well, so Paul, one of the things when we talk about risk tolerance, CISOs are often in the unenviable position of needing to constantly mitigate and manage risk on a daily basis. And at least when I think of, being a security professional myself, but thinking of your typical entrepreneur and startup, I mean, it's the complete antithesis of kind of managing risk, because they're out there pitching and kind of putting it all on the line. They are the risk takers. So how do you reconcile those two things?
So first off, I wouldn't really characterize entrepreneurs as being like risk seekers per se. I'd say that they understand the risk reward trade-off. And the other reality is everyone's risk profile is a little different, right? So for example, for somebody who is maybe right out of college and they're not, they don't have a family to take care of, maybe they have, no debt, they don't have a mortgage to take care of, experience level is relatively low. For them, something that is risky might be wildly risky to the rest of us in this room. In other words, they might seem like they are seeking out risk, because in their situation, a small step up is actually worth it. Like a little bit of a time investment, a small investment monetarily is actually worth it. Their bar is relatively low, say, if compared to somebody who's been working for 10, 20, 30 years. So I always think of it, it's that trade-off. Something that I've seen work well when you are maybe thinking about acting more entrepreneurially, either in a larger organization, or maybe you're going to do something, you're exploring, you're going to do something of your own, externally. Something I call a disposable startup. So the concept here is you can create an environment for yourself where you will go through this process of actually starting, you know, might formally actually go and try to start this new entity, or you might think of it as, hey, I'm just exploring this idea, I'm going to get a group of people gathered around to kick these ideas around, and maybe I will more organically step towards like a product that maybe gets developed. But I see people go through this process. I call it disposable startup because 6 months, a year later, like a short time later, I see teams that look pretty promising. They seem to be hustling, they're working hard. They shut it down. And they move on. But when they do that, the next thing they do actually works much more smoothly because whether intentional or not, what happened in that first setup is they figured out who they like to work with. They had this experience of talking to investors, for example, potential customers. They had all these experiences. They were able to actually get invited in to talk. They never could have done that if they hadn't created this environment for themselves. And so it actually can lower the risk of them doing the next thing. So you can think about how you might take that same approach, even if you stay within the same organization you're in now. Can you create a way to put yourself out there, you know, get even an informal team that's gathered around? And by doing this, you know, does your risk profile actually change over the next 6 months, a year? So that when you do actually want to, deploy, the team and actually invest, in something, maybe it's actually less risky for you to do that. So I call that a disposable startup because the purpose of it is that you go through that process.
So one of the other challenges, just to stay on the risk conversation for a second, but also start to segue into the business skills required, is that, CISOs are in the unique position in that they are charged with protecting the infrastructure of an entire enterprise that already exists. And so the kind of risk tolerance of the organization often already exists, right? Mm-hmm. Whether it's a large conservative, risk averse type of company or organization versus one that's more tolerant of risk. And so there's this often disconnect of how do you align your security strategy and principles with what the overall business and the executive team at the CEO level is kind of mandated, this is what we're willing to bear for the sake of moving the business faster. So it becomes how do you manage your own risk tolerance decisions based on how that inputs into something that already exists, and then how do you also potentially make the case that there needs to be more investment or less investment on certain security principles where it comes into the business skills, how do you start to kind of work mm-hmm. those two things in that particular environment?
Absolutely, and it's a difficult position to be in, really for those reasons. So you might think of what are some of the business skills, some of the rest of this list. What are some of the skills that will help you communicate, both your perspective and actually help you say win a budget, help your organization understand the value of what you are doing. So the list of potential business skills is long, right? Short list that I might focus on are everything from just comfort with numbers, understanding the business model of your own organization, and also just being able to present well. And the presentation piece of this, it's actually really important, and it's something that we might look at someone who presents a little too well as being, they're a little too smooth. But actually, if that is helping them communicate what is important to them, to this organization, it's actually a really good skill. I think of this in a couple of ways. And I have a very very difficult audience that I present to on a regular basis, which is college students, right? So if you can imagine, you don't have just one shot at this audience, and it's like you put everything into it and then you're gone. Imagine standing in front of the same audience for 15 weeks in a row and they're easily distracted, and you know, maybe they would rather be somewhere else. Right? I think of how do you present well, like this. One is if you are not comfortable in front of a group, this is something that you can gain comfort with. One easy hack that I discovered by accident is if you have an upcoming presentation and it's, say it's like to a room like this, right? And that's an unusual and it's an uncomfortable position to be in. You have a lot of people looking at you, right? You are the center of attention for a while. You can desensitize yourself to, you know, the unusual environment by actually trying to place yourself at the front of a room before you have to present. And you just get desensitized to seeing, like, here are, you know, 200 pairs of eyes that are, you know, looking towards you. This is something I discovered really by accident, you know, one time. And eventually, you know, you just get accustomed, you know, to that. If you're in a smaller group setting, again, it's you can desensitize yourself to, you know, to that environment in a, you know, in a little different way, by, you know, actively participating in meetings, like intentionally calling a little attention to yourself, and eventually, like, you get more accustomed to that. But it's really important to be able to communicate well. And a couple other ways that you might think about improving are you can try everything from recording yourself and then watching a video of yourself, you know, giving a talk, you know, later on. Look for good presenters who you can learn from, or if you have colleagues, friends who are actually good at presenting, ask them to evaluate the way that you present your own ideas. Because, like, there's nothing sadder than here's somebody who's really smart, really experienced, and in that conference room, like, the message is just lost.
Yeah. So I would actually be curious, since you've worked with so many startups and entrepreneurs, do you have any good examples or maybe war stories of where you've seen someone, and it goes to the business skill and the presentation, but also the salesmanship, where it's been really effective and what worked for in that particular instance versus maybe the case where it totally tanked and the what not to do by comparison?
I have helped tank a few sales presentations. And the fault was, So I like years and years ago, I was like in product development, and you know, if you can imagine me, like, very, like, you know, even younger and naiver than, you know, more naive than I am now, whatever the word for that is, I would go often with a colleague who's in business development, you know, go call on a, you know, a potential client, and you know, they didn't realize it, but My thing was I would just always tell the truth, right? So, like, I'd be hearing my colleague, you know, say all these things, and I'd be thinking, like, it doesn't do that. That feature is not built out at all. And I'd be thinking, like, why is this guy saying this? And I could just never go along with that. I ended up, like, unintentionally stopping a few early sales, only for them to come back later on, because now there's trust, you know, right? Maybe this is not the way your colleagues want you to do this, right? But you know, you build up a reputation for, well, okay, this guy will actually say, you know, what the real deal is. But a way that you can, apart from that awkward situation, like a way that you can get a little more comfortable is to intentionally create an awkward situation for yourself. So something I have people do, and I definitely have, like, early stage entrepreneurs do, even students do, is starting today. So everybody in this room, actually, I'm not going to tell you yet, but I just want to see, a show of hands, who is in for trying out this next thing I say?
Like, wow.
Five. Oh, actually, I'm going to say.
Welcome to the security
I'm
world.
Going to say, no, I was like, if everybody raised their hand, I would be a little suspicious, but I'm going to say about 25%. So this is something I'm going to suggest that you all try out. And it's going to be something that you do every day for the next 30 days. And it will only take you a couple minutes a day, probably. Every day for the next 30 days, starting today, you are going to intentionally try to get rejected at something. Yes. So it could be something easy in the early days, right? You try to, cut the line to go into one of these sessions, right? You ask for, like a free coffee, outside. It could be something easy like that, and you build your way up to bigger and bigger things. And when I ask people to do this, a couple things happen. First of all, you build up some resiliency to getting used to the word no, right? You're going to have to hear the word no. You're going to have to get rejected a lot. And if that beats you down, and every time you hear that, you have to go off and recover for the rest of the day, that's going to be tough for you to actually go and do some of these other techniques and build your career, build your organization. So one thing is you build up some resiliency. But the second thing is you will often be surprised at how often you don't get rejected. I thought I was asking for something that was it was too much, it was out of line. Nobody would agree to that. It was actually no problem. So when I have people do this, they make money or they save money, they meet new friends, or dates in college, all these things happen, and you come away thinking the world actually operates a little differently than I thought. I thought there were these hard boundaries, I shouldn't do this, shouldn't do that, and actually there isn't a hard boundary there. So that's an easy thing, and the 25% of you who raised your hand, try it starting today. If you do this for a month, you will be you'll be changed, and it will open up new opportunities for you. I'm willing to bet on that.
You can consider yourselves all red teamers of trying to break the RSA security model of getting into rooms.
Yeah.
So one thing that I picked up on, because you talked about your example of trust and sometimes being the unwitting person saying what someone didn't want to hear in the room when you're making a pitch. And I'm actually curious, how often is security professionals in the room? How many of you have had an instance where you have had to be the one to tell the board or the executive team, we're actually not all that great from a security aspect on a certain on a certain front or another? How many of you have actually had to say that? All right, for a good portion of you. Not that I want to put words into mouths, but I would gather that the rest of you, if you haven't said it, you either haven't had the opportunity to, or in some cases, it's a really daunting prospect to tell this, high-powered audience that runs the organization that you support when things aren't so great, And I think that trust point that you made is really important, because even in the work that I've done with boards and on the education of boards and cyber risk management, these are really sophisticated, smart people in the business. They know what they don't know when it comes to security, and they really rely on the security leadership in the room to be the ones to tell us, are we good or are we not good? And sometimes it has to be okay to say, we're not good. And that trust is almost more integral than actually saying, everyone's happy and we made the pitch and we walked out of the room okay, but then the inevitable happens and all of a sudden it kind of comes back and bites us. So that really resonates with me. Great, so I know we talked about this before and it kind of ties a bow back on the risk conversation, but you mentioned that you work with startups in Rome and the Vatican. Tell me about that, because that doesn't seem like it would be your typical risk-taking organization anyway.
No, this is the most risk-averse institution you will encounter. And when I got, about a year ago, when I got the call for doing this, I thought, this is a prank. It was early in the year, so it was before April 1st. I was like, this is a sophisticated, prank. I'm being set up for something. This can't actually be a real thing. But it was real. So the format of this was, the Pope, this is the cool Pope, right? The cool Pope now. He was interested in bringing a lot of the technology that we might be accustomed to here in the Bay Area or in the US, and taking technology that has a benefit to poorer populations around the world, specifically in environmental related issues, and seeing how could we help bring some of this tech to emerging economies. And so Vatican did not put any money into these companies, but we did help them raise some money from private sources. We selected 9 companies from around the world, US, Mexico, Uganda, China, Ecuador, India. And they were doing all different facets of environmental tech, water purification, manufacturing sludge, processing, recycling, all types of businesses. But the interesting thing was, in working with this institution, so this is a picture from a pitch event, in a Vatican building, and you can see regular conference table, we're all seated around here. It's just that the artwork is a lot better on the wall. There's about a 14-foot painting there. And the funny thing about this meeting was, so the guy on the end of the table with the collar, he's a cardinal, he's from Ghana, and he starts talking about how the Vatican is actually, how do they communicate now? So they've obviously moved from writing with quill pens, and he was actually talking about, we're thinking about using Slack, actually. This is fascinating how this old organization starts to modernize. But they've actually had huge problems, or they've had to deal with, I think they have the highest number of botnets per capita, in the world. Not a lot of people live in the Vatican, maybe it's easy. But here's an institution which you think of, everything's on paper, right? Everything is it's not a modern entity. A lot of the communications tech is actually being modernized here. But I like the idea of taking an old, wide-reaching institution and trying to form this hybrid model and bringing these 9 companies that we brought in, combining forces in some way. You might think about how, if you're in larger organizations, you might even think about how this is kind of a fit for you in your own entities. But it was a really interesting experience.
Well, and I love that comparison of, an old organization that has operated a certain way that's kind of going to the future. And when we think about kind of change ahead, how many cases are we, working or supporting as security professionals, businesses that have been around before the advent of technology and are now trying to kind of retrofit a technology environment into how they do things faster, more efficiently, more cost efficiently. And as a result, now we're playing catch up because we're saying, how do we overlay a security strategy? How do we overlay, how do we build out a security organization on top of kind of this pre-existing business model? And one of the things I thought that was interesting is you prepare for that change, because that's really a big change that we're kind of culturally going through. And no one argues that security has become a primary pain point and a priority area for many executives. But when we look at kind of, you mentioned one of the things on the list when we discussed this in advance was curiosity. How does that as a trait, and we think about the trait of curiosity and the trait of being an avid learner in a startup environment, translate to maybe a CISO or a security leader who now has to build out a security program on top of potentially an old and pre-existing structure?
Absolutely. The way I think about this is, I think we are all, as human beings, naturally curious, or we were born naturally curious, right? And maybe sometimes we forget a bit of that, or the environments that we are in, maybe push that down a little bit. I'll suggest a few ways that you might reinvigorate that curiosity, or might get more interested in being an avid learner again. So I came from a telecom background originally, and if you have followed the last 10, 12 years of, say, smartphone development, you might hear about here and there, you might hear about knockoff devices that are developed. And it might look pretty realistic. You might actually visually not be able to notice the difference, but maybe the screen doesn't behave the way the actual device does. Something in the quality is not quite right. There's actually a lot that you can learn from the copycats, or the people who are producing the copycats. And so in China, there's a term called shanzhai, which literally means like, you know, mountain bandit, but is a term for the electronics that are like, you know, copycatted, or they are a bit of a Frankenstein, you know, like, you know, mashup. So I remember, you know, like years ago seeing like devices, like a smartphone, which it wouldn't behave really as well as the, you know, the official device, like the iPhone device, but it had some other feature, some other set of components that actually made it a little more interesting in a different way. So like, so one of them I remember was, you know, it was a phone which had like multiple slots for SIM cards. It's like, oh, why can't I get that? Like in my old iPhone, right? So I would say like look to the places, and this in a CISO environment, this might be like the people who are actually the threat to you. Like look to the way they are operating for a way of getting, you know, getting some ideas and thinking like, oh, what if I put myself in their shoes? Like what are some of the new techniques that they are using to create risk, you know, for me? You actually might get some bit of a new perspective there, or might elicit some creativity. Otherwise, something I would suggest anybody who's working in a tech environment to do is try to do this once a week. Put all the gadgets down, all devices go away, you stay offline, try to get into nature, try to reset yourself. If you can do this once a week, great. If you can do it every few weeks, okay. If you're gonna read something, read it on paper. Like, try just to break that cycle, and you will see like your brain will start to change a little bit, and it will, I think, also help bring out a lot of the latent creativity and curiosity that you
have. So I want to pick on that a little bit, because one thing I also know from my own personal experience and have seen working with other folks in the community and other CISOs is, you know, it's such a reactive environment that we live in on a day-to-day basis. Mm-hmm. And so much of it is just kind of putting out the day-to-day fires, responding to an incident that occurs, kind of thinking through the latest, you know, tweet storm that occurred and who wants a threat assessment on how that's going to impact the business or you name it. And so it really kind of limits, there's just so much going on and there are so many demands on a CISO in particular's time that it kind of sitting, like taking that step back and saying, what is the strategy I want to create? What are the ultimate objectives? How do I kind of take that step back and kind of let not only the creativity, but the ultimate strategy of what I want to achieve, that's really difficult to balance, which I would imagine startups have the same problem because they're putting out a new product and they want to get out the door, but they're not necessarily taking that step back. You know, what are some lessons learned from that community that can help maybe apply in this situation? Because they're all, like, we are all always pressed for time.
It's so true, but it's also, the easy thing to do, though, is just to continue that cycle, right? Okay, I've got to be on all the time, I have to be available all the time. Long-term, though, I think you're better off if you have some break from that and you can reflect, you know, you have some break from that environment and you can just get an input somewhere else. For me, you know, if I can't get into nature, for me, it's music. Like, okay, my job today has nothing to do with music, right? But it just, like, I grew up playing music a lot, right? I just, like, hits me in a different way. The shame would be if you just never have that little break, which actually makes you more effective, but you just can never get that, you know, little break. It's like saying, okay, everyone has to operate on, like, 4 hours of sleep. Eventually, it's going to catch up to you, or almost everybody's going to catch up to you. You know, as much as you can, if you can create that gap in your week, month, you know, I think you'll see the benefit from it. But like, I don't do it myself all the time either, right? Yeah. I'm guilty of the same thing.
Right. Well, I'm sitting here having, you know, visions of how much more compelling a business case would be for a security strategy if you've actually sat down and had some time to sort of absorb and think about it and put it down, as opposed to the last minute, like, we're going to talk to the board in 2 weeks and got to, like, throw together all the metrics and show them something, but it's not actually cohesive because you're just reporting a bunch of metrics, which is often also the case that happens. I won't ask you to raise your hand if that's happened to you. It's happened to me. But so that's a great point to kind of make on the stepping back side. So you know, the last three that when we discussed, because it's all around new growth, and I realize security isn't necessarily new growth in the sense that it's, you know, we're protecting business operations, but a good friend of mine said once, you know, security is actually kind of like the brake on your car. It's not there to slow you down. It's actually there to help enable you to move faster. And so when we think about the principles of how you apply growth and adaptability and problem solving to that concept, what are sort of your thoughts on that?
I might actually suggest that we maybe like kind of talk through a couple of different frameworks. So you'll remember, I work with a lot of early stage companies, but also a few larger organizations who are, say, developing a new product, right? The typical way organizations or individuals will develop something new is it's really this kind of linear process. I'd even say this is just innate to the way people think. Very linear, like, hey, we have this great idea. All right, let's set aside budget for R&D to prototype. You know, now we have the marketing organization, sales organization coming in. And it's a really linear process. It might be a process that lasts years. The risk of this is you have one shot. You have a small number of shots at actually getting it right. And it takes you a long time to figure out, are you actually on the right path or not? So imagine going through this whole process, you come to the end where you launch, or you just do like a targeted launch in a couple of geographies. Nobody actually wanted what you were doing, and you shut it down. This happens all the time. I'm sure you have seen this yourself. This happens all the time. Everybody's smart, like the research is there. It's just we didn't really understand what customers needed. We didn't understand maybe who the customers were. The business model wasn't right. And it took us so long to get to that understanding that we're out of time and it's over. So instead of this process, which we all know and we've all probably been through, I will suggest something a little different, something like this, where set yourself up for many rapid, like short, like low impact tests so that you can actually get a little data, come back and say, okay, I'm going to abandon this handful. Maybe I'll double down on this other handful. Next stage, next stage. So you get many more shots at the goal. Each little gate to pass through is like it's the threshold is much lower than the previous example, that really long process, right? So when I see companies go through this process, it's like this adds some overhead, right? Because now I'm managing maybe instead of one big idea, maybe I'm managing like 50 small ideas in the very beginning and then filtering it down and down and down. This does add some overhead. And it is a little contrary to the way we just naturally want to behave. But when I see people go through this process, you know, the results are they either figure out, hey, we are on the wrong path. Let's stop, let's stop now instead of wasting two more years on this. And it also gives you the openness to be surprised and say, we weren't actually thinking about this other idea seriously. And now, actually, it seems promising. Let's investigate a little further. So as much as you can, I would try to think about how you might introduce this type of a framework. And I'm also happy to talk to you in the Q&A or afterwards about this as well.
I want to put you on the spot on this framework because one of the things that's so different between a startup or building out a new product, and if you're a vendor introducing a new technology, I can see the direct applicability. But if you're on the actual security infrastructure side in-house somewhere, your kind of prototyping and developing is usually a decision between choosing what resources you're going to invest in, which often could be external technologies. It's going to be people that you may or may not bring on board, and what kind of people. And so you're making decisions that are driven by external factors as opposed to building them in-house. But how could you apply this framework to kind of making those decisions? Because I know from my days when I worked in consulting and we would work with large companies, the amount of companies we would go and talk to and you say, well, you've just spent $1.3 million on tools and like 80% of them all do 75% of the same thing, but I'm glad you spent $1.2 million on tools. You know, like I could see where this might have been a helpful upfront process for that evaluation period that just never occurred.
Yeah, I mean, I think it's a really good point. And I did kind of set this up for, say, an external facing organization or a young organization. But I think the way that you're describing this, like that process applies in a different way for a CISO or for a security organization.
Do you think it still applies?
I'm going to put this out to the group. I mean, like, I don't want to be too theoretical for your own businesses, but has anyone here either gone through something like this or thought about this? A couple people. Just takes a while for the hands to go up, all right. So maybe that's something that we can have as a discussion later on.
Okay. So, Paul, in summary, because I think this is a really interesting kind of discussion point to end on, and before we open it up for questions and answers, what do you think, even having worked with startups, and you've obviously seen those that have been really successful at kind of taking this idea, prototyping it, doing it along the way, and succeeding versus those that have kind of, led the way and failed, what would be the one big takeaway you would say applies to a security-minded audience where, again, we talked about risk in the beginning, the ROI is really hard to calculate. Because when I get to the end of my pitch and I'm the entrepreneur, I'm going to tell someone, you invest, X amount in me and I'm going to give you back 10X. And in the security world, we're saying, give me X and if you're lucky, nothing will happen. And that's about the best we can do.
And you want me to solve this problem
right now?
I see. Oh my. Well, I think the reality is you are in a growth industry. Like, cybersecurity is not going to be something that goes away. If anything, it's only becoming more important. Maybe it's time that we stop thinking of this part of almost every business as being just a cost center. And instead, we should start to think of it as, there are active ways that you can apply security strategically. If your competitors are not, performing at the same level as your company, maybe there is an ROI, for security organizations.
Right. So it all goes back to we have to be better at communicating the value proposition of our programs and strategies to our executive teams and boards so that they start to buy into the culture change of actually not looking at it just as a cost center, which means that we should probably take our poor IT team and take them out of that like fishbowl area we keep them in where they're not interacting with any other people. Okay, just note to self. Any other questions from the audience or things that you all want to throw out from your own experience as we wrap up the last few minutes we have together? It's very bright, I can't see. Yes?
So I think you might have possibly
there actually have been a lot of initiatives in the last like 5-6 years for like bringing lean startup techniques, at least into, I'm not sure what agency you're in, but like at least into some parts of the government. It's probably just scratching the surface today. I would actually suggest like taking a look at what is either out there already. Like if you, I think like Steve Blank, you know, is one of the organizers who like through National Science Foundation actually like has changed the way that like proposals are like, you know, for government grants are developed. So I'm happy to talk to you about like some ideas afterwards, but apart from saying like I would actually just look like literally just look into where else say lean startup is being used in a government agency. But it's almost like I get that it's a little frustrating, you know, government, I work in a university. I would even say like that's, you know, maybe not as difficult as a government, you know, kind of role, but universities move really slowly, you know. Even just finding the right person to talk to is often like, you know, bewildering, right? So I would get at, you know, I would actually get things done by just saying like, it's gonna take you a year at least to figure out that I did that thing, so I'm just gonna do it now. And then later on, like, oh, I wasn't supposed to do that, oh, okay. And then it will take you another year to check that I actually stopped. So like, that's been my protocol. Do not tell this to anybody at USC. That's been the way I've actually moved like faster than you know, officially in this current role. But I don't know, I'm happy to talk to you about like other ideas.
I would say, you know, yeah. I spent some time in government, and not that I want to advocate for asking forgiveness and not permission, but you know, you look at some of the initiatives in the government sector that are actually pretty innovative. And that clearly came about because someone was willing to press on those issues. So the DOD, the Department of Defense, has a bug bounty program now. That did not happen because a like bureaucrat army officer, no offense, you know, said we should start a bug bounty program. So I think the persistence and going back to even some of the presentation skills and kind of being that advocate and having the confidence is really important. And then it's just the patience to be the squeaky wheel to constantly be the advocate for that particular, you know, initiative, whatever that idea might be. Any other, I think we have time for one last question. Yeah.
In regards to the rapid experimentation model, how would you go about, I guess, positioning that and getting approval from like an executive team or a board?
It's a little different from what people are used to, right? So the, like, I would say, I think the part of the message should be this actually reduces some risk, right? Rather than making, here's the budget and we have like one shot or a small number of shots to get things right, here is the way that we can actually take maybe a similar budget and just have gates. In other words, we pass through this one gate, which maybe is like you're looking at a particular like data set. You have to reach a certain threshold or some kind of metric that defines do you proceed or not, right? How would you spend that budget based on those incremental results that you get over time? So I would hope that the reaction that you get is, oh, actually, you're helping reduce the risk of this potential project rather than, oh, like, you know, this is a little different, we just don't want to do it. So I would go back to like, how do you convey this information? Maybe look to other organizations who apply this and start to think about, well, like, how do we maybe try something like this in-house? But really, like, I hope that the reaction is, oh, okay, this only reduces risk. You know, even if it's just like I'm taking this portfolio approach to here's a set of problems. Here are many ways we could apply potential solutions. So I'm hoping like that risk mitigation factor is going to help with what, you know, with your proposal.
Thanks. So Paul, I appreciate you taking the time to kind of chat with us all. And I think one of the big, you know, themes I heard across all this was the iterative process of not just how you apply these principles in this kind of rapid experimentation model if we were to all leave our jobs and go into a startup world, but that maybe our security programs can be just as iterative and just as experimentally based. And then it just comes down to how we kind of create those milestones and gate things and then communicate them with all the practice and music listening and walks in nature that we need to take as we go outside and enjoy some of the San Francisco weather. So thank you so much for joining us. I appreciate all of you. Thank you for joining us and enjoy the rest of your afternoons and conference.